welcome to St. Francis Church for our online service. I wonder how you are feeling today. I wonder what here represents how you're feeling. Perhaps you feel like this corn this week that's extremely dry. Perhaps you're feeling dry and just not got a lot of life, not got a lot of oomph at the moment. Perhaps you're feeling like these plants that are looking reasonably healthy. You're feeling reasonably healthy, but there's not a lot of colour and vitality. Perhaps you are a bit more like this plant. It's got aspects of great health. Parts of it look really healthy and parts of it look a little bit wizened. And maybe that's part of our lives. Part of our life is looking good. Part of our life is struggling. Well, however we are feeling today and whatever situation we are in, by spending time in God's presence, spending time worshipping Him, spending time learning from Him and receiving from Him, my prayer is that by the end of the service, we are in greater health. We are in a better spiritual place. Let's invite God to meet with us throughout the whole of this service, and particularly right now. So, loving God, would you come to each of us right now? Would you fill us with your Spirit? Perhaps there's something you already want to offer to God to say, God, bring life to that part of me. Or maybe saying, God, I need you. I want you. I need you in my life more. Lord, would you help us to give you praise and worship? And would you help us have hearts that are open to whatever you want to do in us? Amen. Let's worship.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Saviour on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's transfixed on Jesus' face.
Christian life is full of three things. It should always be full of love. It should always be full of joy. And it should always be full of peace. But the reality is that when we're in the midst of life, things happen to us that steal our peace, steal our joy, and stop us from feeling that we are loved and lovable. And when we come to God with our confession, it's our way of re-establishing that relationship. Once we have confessed, we can know the joy of forgiveness. We can know that we're absolutely loved, even though we've properly messed up. And we can know that peace, that God is with us, He is for us, He is in control, and whatever we face, we can know peace. So love, joy, and peace should be something that we hold on to always and notice when we're not living in those things. So let's come to God now, recognizing where we are not got love and joy and peace in our life, where we've done things that we regret and have broken this relationship with God. Let's pray. God our Father, we come to you in sorrow for our sins, for turning away from you and for ignoring your will for our lives. Father, forgive us, save us and help us. For behaving just as we wish without thinking of you. Father, forgive us, save us and help us. For failing you by what we do and think and say. Father, forgive us, save us and help us. For letting ourselves be drawn away from you by temptations in the world about us. Father, forgive us, save us and help us. For living as if we were ashamed to belong to your Son. Father, forgive us, save us and help us. May Almighty God, who sent his Son into the world to save sinners, bring you his pardon and peace, now and forever. Amen. And the prayer set aside for this Sunday. Almighty God, whose most dear Son went not up to joy, but first he suffered pain, and entered not into glory before he was crucified, mercifully grant that we, walking in the way of the cross, may find it none other than the way of life and peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Drown and storm. From the first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 1, verses 18 to 25. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scholar? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of the proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews ask for signs and Greeks desire wisdom. But we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Some of us really love conversations with people. In fact, many of us probably do. But there may be some watching this who just find conversations quite awkward most of the time. Maybe it's to do with embarrassment or shyness or a sense of social awkwardness, and that's hard to live with, isn't it? And we pray that God gives you grace in your conversations. But those that do find conversations quite okay, quite easy, there are conversations that do fill us with a sense of awkwardness and embarrassment. Maybe you've had to do one of those conversations to break up a relationship, whether that be a romantic relationship or a friendship, and you just know that the relationship or the friendship is just not helpful or just not working, and you just need to have a distance. And it can be so awkward having that conversation. Or maybe you were with a younger person and you're their parent or their grandparent or their uncle or their auntie, and they're asking you the question about where babies come from, and you know, because you've been told, that it's your responsibility to tell them, and it can feel so awkward having that conversation, even though it's an important conversation to have and it has to be entered into really carefully, but it can feel really awkward. Or there's a host of other conversations that we have that do make us feel awkward. And sadly, for many Christians throughout the world, when someone asks us about our faith, we can find that really awkward, really embarrassing, in fact. And we feel terrible about it, but that can be the case. We can feel really comfortable talking about church or about activities. Maybe we feel happy talking, in our case, about the cafe or about youth work or family's work or older people's work, and that's all okay. But if we're talking about why worship is important to us, or why the cross is important to us, or why our personal faith is important, we can feel really awkward and uncomfortable, and I don't want us to be like that, and I know that you don't want to be like that either. So in today's talk, we're going to be thinking about some of the reasons why it can feel awkward, and how Paul talks about that, and I hope that we'll get some resources that will help us to speak more confidently about Jesus and what he's done for us. So Paul is writing to the church in Corinth. It's a place that is really a well-to-do place in general. There's lots of intellectualism going on. There's lots of valuing of rhetoric and clever speech. And Paul is speaking to them about the cross. And he's saying how the cross is a stumbling block to many, and it seems as foolishness to many. But he says, just before today's passage, he says, for God did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel, not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross might be emptied of its power. He's not trying to speak with great wisdom here in Corinth. He had been speaking with great wisdom in Athens and quoted their philosophers and quoted their poets, and it was an amazing speech, but it didn't really have a huge impact, actually. Some people believed, but many didn't. And he's in Corinth and he's thinking, I'm not going to go that way. I'm going to really focus on the power of God and the wisdom of God and the power of the cross. And he says, but the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. Those that are going in a direction of travel away from God just think you're crazy talking about the cross and this supposed saviour, this supposed king that is dying a humiliating death on the cross. At the time, the only ones that died on the cross were criminals, were slaves, were people that had been traitors. Roman citizens were not allowed to be killed on a cross. It was seen as so humiliating. They didn't like to talk about the cross in polite company because it was seen as so shameful. And yet, Paul is saying, no, this is central to our message. I'm going to talk about it, even though people find it difficult. And he says, for those who are being saved, it is the power of God. And he quotes the Old Testament saying, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. God is above everything. And what is seen as wise in human terms is seen as foolishness by God. And even God's foolishness is wiser than the greatest wisdom on earth. And he's going, well, where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? The wisdom of God. The world did not know God through wisdom. God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. God saved them through their proclamation of Christ crucified. The Jews wanted an unmistakable sign to prove that Jesus is the Messiah, that he is the Saviour, that he is the Rescuer. The Greeks wanted some eloquent wisdom to prove that Jesus is the Messiah. But Paul says, but we're proclaiming the message that God gives us, which is proclaiming about the Christ who is crucified. The humiliated Messiah is our message. The one who took on the cross, who took on the humiliation, who took on the guilt and the shame and defeated it and rose again, he is our Messiah. He recognises that this is a stumbling block. Jews in their scriptures have this verse that says that cursed is anyone who dies on the cross. They cannot get their head around the idea that the one who died on the cross is God himself, is our saviour. And it's through the cross that salvation comes. They just can't get their head around that. And the Gentiles just think it's all foolishness and silliness. But for those who are being called, for those who God is reaching out to, it is the wisdom of God and the power of God. And so when we speak about God, we want to speak in a way that makes sense to the person that we're speaking to. We need to feel confident that our message, coupled with God's power, can change lives in every culture, every age group. The message of what Jesus has done on the cross is powerful. But for those who are currently walking away from God or whose life is not interested at all in God, it will seem like foolishness. It will be a stumbling block. But to those that are beginning to be interested in God, it is the thing that will save them when they realise what Jesus has done on the cross. That is my story. I was on a journey towards God, and when I read a chapter of a book that explained about what the cross had meant, even though I had received teaching on this way in the past. When I read it at a point in my life where I was open to God, it suddenly made absolute sense, and I repented, I confessed my sins, and I turned to God. It was the power of the cross that saved me, and it's the power of the cross that is the way to salvation. But there's all sorts of ways of speaking about the cross. It depends who we are speaking with. If we're speaking to someone and we sense from God this is the route, then we can talk mainly about how the cross removes guilt and shame. We can talk about how it was such a shameful thing at the time for someone to be crucified naked on a cross, but to say that Jesus took on that shame, he allowed the shame, he allowed the guilt to just completely cover him, so that we don't have to completely be covered with guilt and shame. His death, his dying and rising again means that guilt and shame don't need to hold on to us. And we can talk about examples from our life or the life of others where they have felt like a burden has been taken off them. You could focus on the way that the cross takes away our sin. We could talk about Isaiah 53, where it says that the Lord has laid on him the sin of us all, and that he takes it away from us so that we don't need to hold on to it. We can talk about how he takes our sins as far as the east is from the west, so we can know the gift of forgiveness. Through the cross, there is forgiveness. That might be the thing. Or it may be we talk about breaking the power of sin in our life, breaking the power of evil. We may talk about how Jesus wins a great victory on the cross, that he broke the power of death through his rising again. We ultimately will talk about all those aspects of the cross and more, but we need to work out, well, what is the way in for this person? What do they really need to know? Or it may be that we really focus on how God's love is demonstrated on the cross. Someone that you know, they are not convinced that they are loved and lovable. We can talk about how Jesus choosing the cross and choosing to stay on that cross out of love for you and me, and how he did it even though many would choose to reject the cross. He did it and would have done it even if there were very few that accepted, and you could say to the person, even if it was just you, he would do it. So great is his love for you, a sign of the greatest love. And there's that lovely phrase, it wasn't the nails that held Jesus on the cross, but it was his love for you and me. He chose to stay on the cross to deal with all our bad stuff and to enable us to be free. There are loads of ways of speaking of the cross. And to those that are ready, it is the wisdom of God. It is the power of God. Those that are not ready, we can pray. We can witness through our love in actions. We can witness through our faithfulness to that person, that our consistency in friendship. And we can pray that their heart gets to a place where they are ready to receive. The cross may be foolishness to some. It may be a stumbling block to others, but to those who are being saved, it is the power of God. Let's pray. Lord, your cross is amazing. It's amazing what you've done. It's amazing that you're willing to take on the physical pain of the cross, but you're willing to take on the humiliation of the cross, that you're willing to take on the sin of the world upon your body on the cross. And you're willing to do that out of love for us. Thank you for what you've achieved through the cross. Would you help us to be people that are confident in speaking about the cross? Would you give us your wisdom in knowing how to speak? Would you bring to mind stories of the impact that the cross has had on us and on others that we can share? Jesus, we want to say thank you. Thank you for the cross. It's amazing what you've done. And even right now, let's allow Holy Spirit to meet with us. We can have knowledge of the cross, but we need to also have an experience of the power of the cross in us. So Lord, would you cause our head knowledge to become heart knowledge, an experience of what you've done, an experience of your great love for us, an experience of the weight of sin being taken off us, an experience of shame leaving and love staying. Surround us with your love. Fill us with your love. And would you equip and empower us to be your witnesses? Help us to talk with Christians about just how precious the cross is as a way of practice, and then help us to be ready to talk with those that are not Christians. To witness to the power of the cross, Christ crucified. Amen. The cross of Jesus and the resurrection of Jesus is central to our faith. We are not ashamed of the cross. We do preach Christ crucified. And let's now proclaim the faith of the words of the Creed. So let us declare our faith in the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. He was buried. He was raised to life on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. Afterwards, he appeared to his followers and to all the apostles. This we have received and this we believe. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, through your grace, we are your people. Through your Spirit, you have redeemed us. In your Spirit, you have made us your own. We pray for the church. We pray for new Christians, both locally in this church and throughout other churches. We pray for people that have been Christians for a while. Pray that both would have great enthusiasm for you. Great love for you and a desire to draw closer to you, a desire to live a life that is good and holy and honourable to you. Have a desire to share you with others through words and action. Make each of our hearts ready to respond to your love and your calling. Lord, receive our praise and hear our prayer. We pray for our local area. We pray for our city. We pray for our country and our world. We recognize such pain and brokenness is all around us. But we recognize that you are the God who will one day make all things new. Would you work through us to bring healing and help to those in need? Would you work through us to bring a greater measure of justice and righteousness in this world? May our lives bear witness to your glory. Lord, receive our praise and hear our prayer. We pray for those who are in need at the moment, those in hospital, those who are suffering at home, body, mind and spirit. In the silence, we lift them to you. Would you bring help and healing? Lord, receive our praise and hear our prayer. Make us one in heart and mind to serve you with joy forever. Amen. Hope this time together has caused you to feel closer to God, caused you to feel that you have recaptured the love and joy and peace that God wants to give you. Pray that you would flourish as you go through this week. I pray that you would feel more confident to speak about the faith, about Jesus who died on the cross and rose again. Let's receive the blessing then. Christ, the Good Shepherd who laid down his life for the sheep, draw you and all who hear his voice to be one flock within one fold. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you now and always. Amen.